My background is structural engineering. This was a project of mine when I was at the University of Michigan in my graduate program. And I brought the technology out through the technology transfer process in the late 1990s, founded the company in the early 2000s. And, you know, I was looking at that S-curve that Rick was showing, and, you know, yeah, that is definitely the curve. And what's really exciting for me, you know, even though we're, you know, quite a few years later, we're really starting at Helix, starting to see that shift from, you know, onto that steeper part of the curve. So through all of this, I've had the opportunity to really not only kind of shepherd this technology through those phases, but I've gotten to really experience how construction's done really throughout the world at this point. So at this point, Helix, you know, like I said, it's based in Ann Arbor, Michigan. We have manufacturing in Michigan, but it's become a global company with global significance. So we have operations throughout the world. I just got back from Australia. We do a significant amount of business in Asia, as well as Latin America and the Middle East. So it's really becoming something that you know, is very significant on a global scale. But it started much like ICF did, you know, as a very new technology in an industry that just doesn't change quickly. So, you know, let's just talk real quickly about what we're doing here in the Vancouver market. And this is a really exciting project, the Ocean Cottages project. I'm going to talk a little bit about how Helix is going to be applied in this particular project. But as I was talking to Michael earlier, I was asking him if he had any of those left because they look awful nice. But you know, it's actually going to use a lot of the technologies that we're talking about today. ICF, you know the floor systems, and it's going to use Helix. So we'll come back to that in a minute, and we'll talk a little bit about the technology. And this is a video that I like to show because it kind of it illustrates, you know, sort of what the direction we're going with Helix. Now, there have been products that are fiber reinforcements that have been available for concrete, you know, for decades. Those products are really limited in their application to slabs on grade. And we'll talk about why in a minute, but a good portion of what we do, probably almost 80%, is actually vertical applications. Helix is a unique in that it actually has the structural capability to do stuff like this. This is a seven-story Hilton Garden Hotel where we replaced more than half of the reinforcement in this building with Helix. And as a result, we'll talk about the value. There's significant value to the contractor, just in ease of construction, but to the developer, there's even more value. And that's where we're really starting to see more interest from the owner and developer market, because they're seeing not only the life cycle benefit of this, but also if I can save the developer of this hotel a month of construction, there's a lot of money there for them to find, you know, if they can open that facility a little bit earlier. So again, we'll kind of come back to that. We're going to go all the way back to the beginning now and talk about why Helix, what was the whole purpose of Helix. Helix was developed at the University of Michigan with funding from the Department of Defense, really for blast resistance. And the unique thing about Helix and blast resistant applications is we can actually create concrete that is blast resistant, that is less expensive or equally as expensive as ordinary concrete. Now, if you go back into kind of the Cold War era and stuff, and you see what the government was doing with fibers and concrete, they would put so much fiber into concrete that they had to basically put the fiber in the form first and then pour concrete over the top of it. And the result is your concrete was like $1,000 a cubic meter. Here, this concrete is actually less expensive. And I put it on here because it sort of illustrates what Helix does. We have customers that actually use it for this. There's this whole prepper community that kind of, you know, we tend to service a little bit, who are building blast-resistant homes. And, you know, I was just in Las Vegas last week, and somebody's building a bunker in under their house, and they're using Helix. So there is application for this. But the reason I talk about it is because see all these little fine cracks that you get with Helix? That's the crux of what we're going to talk about. Concrete is brittle. It has no tensile resistance. So when it's hit with that explosive charge, it just crumbles around the rebar. The rebar does have that ductile property, but you can only do so much with the marriage of the two materials, because the two materials don't really work together. The concrete fails first, and then the bar can start to carry load. So Helix changes that from an engineering perspective to more of a composite. So instead of, you know, getting that fracturing, you get strength throughout the concrete, and you get that sort of more flexible ductile behavior built right into the concrete. So as I said, we have customers that use it for that application, but most of what we do is just ordinary concrete, and that ranges from your typical slab on grade. I've got individual contractors who've done nearly 10 million square meters to date of slab, industrial slab on grade type work. Floor systems, whether it's slab on grade or above deck, and that would include slab on metal deck, and also some of the more, I guess alternative systems like the wood panel, the Hambro type systems we've worked with as well. ICF, that building there is a 65,000 square foot residence in Missouri that has, you know, that house is actually, it's designed for sort of the worst case scenario. So 300 millimeter thick walls, Helix at I think 25 kilograms. Even the cladding, which I'll talk about in a second, is a ballistic resistant cladding that goes on top of the ICF building. So, you know, this thing could survive a direct hit of an F5 tornado, which is what it's actually designed. It's actually the design condition is an F5 tornado sitting right on top of it. So, and then they're also looking concerned about impact. So if that F5 tornado picked up a semi-truck and hit it, they want the building to be serviceable. So, you know, that's kind of the extreme case. And then if you just go down the coast here, the Seattle Pier 57 Ferris wheel actually has all the foundations underneath it are reinforced with Helix. So that represents sort of a seismic application in a foundation. So really a broad application. We're almost 15 years now, 36 countries use. So just a little bit about the science, and then we'll get into some more application sort of case studies. If you think about that first slide we talked about, we're talking about making a composite with concrete. So rebar, you know, fibers, any other sort of product that you put into concrete, it works as a two-part system. So the concrete, if you're in reinforced concrete design class, one of the first things they'll tell you is that concrete first has to crack before the rebar starts to carry any load. So that's the same thing with fibers, anything, any other thing that you put into the concrete to carry load. The concrete is so stiff and brittle relative to the reinforcement that it has to crack so the reinforcement can slip a little bit. So in the case of rebar, those ridges on the rebar can engage and start to pick up the load. Or if you've got, say, a plastic fiber or something in there, it has to crack large enough that plastic can stretch so that it can start to carry load. So Helix, on the other hand, works more like your true composite, an aircraft type composite, whereas it's twisted and it's very stiff, so it has very good bond to the concrete, and it's very stiff relative to concrete. So instead of having to first allow a large crack to form, it can start to carry load before the concrete actually forms visible cracking. And that's sort of the intent of our design and how we approach concrete design. Now, we're not saying Helix will prevent cracking altogether. There is a point at which the concrete can crack, but this is the only product that can actually benefit the concrete or improve the concrete's ability to resist that crack from the first place. All the other technologies that are out there, they just allow the concrete to crack. So we're not giving up on the concrete. We're trying to make the concrete better, unlike what you do with rebar. So I won't get into the details here. This is kind of explaining what I mentioned about rebar. Main thing is, in order for rebar to work, the concrete first has to crack, and then it starts to carry load. Helix is very unique, as I said, because of that bond strength that it has. It's actually a twisted piece of metal. So this is an actual piece of it here. There's a sample out here at our booth. It looks like a little screw. So on a very simple base, it locks itself in like a screw and doesn't come out. If you think a little bit more about, you know, the next level, you look at this video here, and what actually has to happen if the concrete actually were to crack, and you start to get more load applied to the helix, it actually has to untwist for that crack to grow any larger than just that hairline. So that untwisting behavior gives it a very stable resistance to tension, regardless of how much stretching or how much tension you get into the concrete, so that it behaves in a way that's similar to rebar after the concrete cracks. Before the concrete cracks, you get something that, you know, is difficult to achieve without adding more cement or changing the base properties of the concrete that Chris was talking about. It actually increases the modulus of rupture of the concrete. So the more helix you put in there, the modulus of rupture is the measure of how much it takes to crack the concrete and bend it. It increases that baseline parameter. So we have two products. The product that you'll see most often is the Helix 525 product. And there's a big tub of it out here. I encourage you to stop and kind of play with it. 25 millimeters long, half millimeter in diameter. It actually has a building code approval for replacing structural rebar in concrete. The 852 product is a product that's twice as long. We don't have a sample of it here, but it's really used for like tunneling. So tunnel boring machine technologies, precast tunnel linings, and things like that. So we'll focus mainly on this 525 product. Just to kind of finish up the engineering side of it, the whole idea is very fascinating from a sort of pure science perspective, but the engineering community over this period of sort of that early adopter phase kept coming back to us and saying, this is great, but how do I compare it to rebar? You know, if I want to design with this, if you want me to take rebar out, how can I do that? Because all the testing we had from the university didn't do that. So what we did is we did just that. We ran the same test at an independent lab that they run for rebar, which is this ASTM E111. It's just, you put the rebar in the machine and you pull it until it breaks and it plots that sort of stress strain curve. We did the same thing for Helix, but with a cylinder of concrete that has sort of a dog bone shape to it. And we found, you know, very interesting properties that we knew were there from what we were seeing in the bending tests. But, you know, again, it just reinforced what I was mentioning before. It increases the amount of force it takes to crack the concrete. It actually increases the flexibility of the concrete. So this is sort of the vertical scale is how much force it takes to crack the concrete. The horizontal scale is how much the concrete stretches before it fails. So what this red curve is helix. The green one is the normal concrete. The normal concrete, the steeper that slope, the more brittle the concrete is. So normal concrete goes up, in this case, to about 9,000, and it snaps with very little stretching. With the helix, it stretches almost five times as much, and it doesn't crack until you get up to, you know, more like 10,000 newtons. So we're making more flexible, more crack-resistant concrete. And that's sort of the science behind it. Now, we kind of go through the whole progression of the curve, and I'm not going to get into all these details here because I want to get to the case studies. But the main point is we've taken this data and we've developed through an arm's length process with IATMO or a uniform evaluation service, a design method that's based on the load resistance factor design approach that creates structures that are structurally as reliable as rebar reinforced concrete structures with Helix. And if anybody would like to kind of get some more details on that process and how that is done, you know, stop by the booth. But we have been doing this now. Helix has, as I said, been around for 15 years. This report came out in 2013, and it has really made a tremendous difference in terms of the adoption of this product, because this report gives the engineering community as well as the building official community the basis to do this structural replacement of rebar. And it's all based on third-party ISO accredited laboratory testing. And from an engineering perspective, it provides a design approach that's very similar to what the engineering community is used to. In essence, you can design with Helix now. If you basically have an existing rebar structure, this report allows you to take that rebar structure and convert that rebar structure into an equivalent Helix structure. As well as providing all of the required sort of field quality assurance requirements, and all the calculations and basis necessary to do that. So again, there's a lot of detail there. I'm not going to get into it here. I encourage you to stop by. We have some copies of the report. As I said, it includes design instructions, the restrictions, examples, and field quality assurance requirements. And just to give you a sense, this is just kind of what it looks like in terms of the examples that you get. And there are even quick reference tables in the back. So if you don't want to get into all the calculations, you can very quickly go into these tables if you have an existing rebar structure and calculate. In this case, I had a 150 millimeter structure. I was just in Australia, so the N12 is a 12 millimeter rebar at 300 millimeter center. So that's like a number 4 bar. And you just you read from the thickness over and the spacing, the size of the bar, and it gives you 12 kilograms of Helix. So that's really kind of the dosage range that we work in. You can see we go from about 5 kilograms up to about 18 for typical applications in ICF. We have design software that we can make available to any of the engineers in the room who are interested. You would just need to get in touch with me, and it will basically do the design of those structures in accordance with this report for you in a much more sort of user-friendly manner. So if we circle back to the Ocean Cottages project, based on what we've talked about here, we have a number of different types of structures in this building. The main thing that we're using Helix in is in the ICF walls. There's also some floor applications, but I'm going to talk specifically about this ICF wall on the lower level, which is it's a below grade wall that has soil on one side, and it's an 8-inch thick wall. So we typically will look at these structures if it's an above grade wall or if the loads are relatively light. We can do a complete replacement of rebar with Helix. In this particular case, we are proposing a hybrid design, which will include some rebar as well as Helix. In this case, unlike what I was mentioning earlier, we didn't have an original design. We just have the soil load parameters. So we have the ability to, just typical calculations to calculate the bending moment that was on the wall. So in this case, we calculated a 250 kip inch per foot bending moment on that wall based on the soil pressures. And from that, then, we can use the software I mentioned before to calculate an equivalent Helix section. In this case, you'll see the output of our software here is telling us, based on that report again, that we would use 25 pounds per yard of helix, and that's going to give us 250.7 kip inches per foot of bending capacity in that wall.
So is that just the bottom floor 8-inch CF wall?
Yeah.
And then as you go up to a 6-inch wall, 7-inch,
right. Yeah, so basically it's all going to be based on either the original rebar in there, we're going to back calculate the bending moment that's required, or an initial an original design calculation like this, where we're taking that demand and then converting that demand into a helix dosage. So this was the most technically challenging part. I believe there was some rebar that was left in this as well. But what the software gives you is about a 10-page submittal that walks you through every single aspect of the design. And from a value perspective, it's also showing you how much additional shear strength you get. You know, you get shear strength with helix because there's pieces in all directions. In this case, it's a 240% increase. You get more durability. You get 26% increase in that modulus of rupture, that crack strength. And one of the things, those are values that are interesting from an engineering perspective. But I can point to a project where we did we've done now 10,000 homes with helix because of that modulus of rupture increase, because it decreases the cracking that they get in the walls and the possibility of water infiltration into the buildings. So in this particular case, we're also applying it to the 6-inch, the above grade walls at a lower dosage and helix only. So in these lower floors, it's a combination of helix and rebar because the loads are higher, and there's certain restrictions in the report that drive us to that. And in the above grade levels, it's a helix only solution. The end result will be a building that has that crack resistance. It's on the coast, so even though it's got the ICF, you're going to have that additional crack resistance to protect it from any water infiltration. It's going to increase the speed of construction. If I go back to that original example that I was showing earlier, and I get back into this Hilton Garden Hotel, they saved, just by using helix, they did some other technologies or changes in the way they used a panelization method on this that saved even more time. But just the use of helix saved 10 days of construction, because they eliminated all the horizontal rebar in this building. So that eliminated a lot of the time that it took to try to get that horizontal bar into the ICF forms. And it also, the pouring of the concrete goes a lot faster because you're not concerned about voids forming as much, because you don't have that horizontal bar potentially holding up the concrete as it's going in there. So we're seeing a lot of interest from the development community because of that time savings, because for a hotel operator, even 10 days, I've got another one where we've saved over a month, is very significant in terms of their time to revenue. So all the way across the board, there's benefit. The direct costs associated, are somewhat neutral, but the time savings, there's also the opportunity to thin concrete. ICF doesn't really use a lot of 4-inch forms or 100 millimeter thick forms now because the rebar congests it too much to use it. There's a real opportunity with helix to use 4-inch forms in above grade structures, in particular with helix. So there's opportunity there as well. We're working on tools to actually quantify that for both contractors and owners. And this is just a preview, but on our website we will have a what's called a value matrix that actually calculates that CO2 reduction, the time savings, and all those things. But those are sort of the aspects that are sort of driving us to the point where we are now, really kind of on that steeper part of the curve. I mean, we've done stadiums. We showed the Ferris wheel. This is a project in Waterloo. 25 stories where we replaced about half the bar, pavements, windmill, industrial pavements. These are very heavy duty pavements in Mexico. Companies like FedEx, Amazon.com, A lot of institutional work, hotels. This is that housing development down in Florida that has the 10,000 homes now. This was the slides a couple years old. You know, we've got some pretty cool, this is all ICF down in actually St. Martin. This is that large structure we talked about. We've got almost 15,000 of these storm shelters now in service throughout the South. And I actually, learned to appreciate that. I was down in San Antonio, almost got hit by a tornado a couple weeks ago. So these things are Helix only. They've been tested at Texas Tech to be fully compliant with FEMA's requirements for storm shelters. You name it, we've been in it at this point. And I think that's part of sort of this whole shift. When we were starting out, we didn't have a whole lot of applications to point to. But at this point, if anybody came up to me at the booth and said they've got a particular type of structure, a particular type of project, I can point to four or five that we've done and that have been successful. And I think in construction, people want to see that. They want to see that, and they want to see projects in their backyard too. You know, everybody kind of, you know, and there is a little truth to it. Concrete is different in different parts of the world, but we're really starting to get a lot of traction, in particular in the areas that we've been in. And Brick's done a good job kind of bringing Helix to this market, and we're really excited about continuing that process. I really have to say my hats off to the ICF community, because you are innovators. One of my first customers in Colorado was a project, it was a townhome project, ICF townhome project, and what I find is the community, they're just looking, they're forward thinking, and that's really refreshing in the construction business. So there's a lot here to cover. I've kind of very quickly gone through this, so I've got the booth. I'm happy to speak with anybody about what they're doing in more detail, but does anybody have any questions? Yes, sir.
Luke, can you comment on your current thinking and methodology on disbursement in the concrete and how the ready-mix companies are adapting to this?
Yeah, I mean, that's a great question. It's probably, one of the more common questions we have is disbursement. So obviously Helix is randomly dispersed into the concrete, and there's not a lot that you can do to control that. You have to accept the randomness of it. So the beauty of that load and resistance factor design approach is that it has a methodology where you measure, you characterize what the variability of the distribution of the Helix is in the concrete. So we did field testing to characterize that. And we actually measured at the dosage, in the dosage range that a lot of this stuff is being used, that variation is 20-25%, that coefficient of variation. So what the load and resistance factor design approach requires you to do when you see that kind of variation is apply a large factor of safety. So you're sure that you have at least the minimum amount of reinforcement that you need to carry your loads in that area based on a confidence interval that's defined on the based on the consequence of failure for a structure. So a slab on grade, that it might allow you to get a little closer to the margin, because the worst thing that happens is somebody gets a crack and they're unhappy. But in a wall or an above grade structure, our factors of safety are as high as 9.5. But believe it or not, there's still value in there because rebar is just so difficult to get to work with.
But how are the ready-mix companies actually?
So there's two ways. I skipped that slide. There's two ways to add Helix. The best way, and the way that we recommend to all customers now, is to add Helix to the truck first. You put it in the truck with a little bit of the water. You mix it, and it breaks it all apart, and it's practically distributes itself.
It's not clumping out of the box.
It doesn't clump. I mean, so obviously, clumping is one of the things you want to watch out for. But if you put it in first, you don't have that issue. We also have a new form of packaging that actually packs the Helix
parallel,
which makes that easier. But it's not really. We found it's not really that necessary. If you put the Helix in first, you don't even need that. So if you have to put the Helix in on the job site, we have what we call a sifter, which you sit on top of the truck and you shake it through a screen to make sure it breaks up. But it's the combination of having that water and having the Helix alone in the truck with the water that breaks it up. And the only time we ever have problems is when people don't follow our instructions. They put it in dry, or they don't mix it. They'll just put the Helix in with the water and they just have it sort of at idle speed. They don't have it at mixing speed. You gotta put it in, you gotta mix it for 2-3 minutes before you go charge the truck. You do that and you won't get any clumps.